Harper Audio presents Dead in the Water by Stuart Woods, performed by Tony Roberts. Stone Barrington slowly opened his eyes and stared blearily at the pattern of moving light above him. Disoriented, he tried to make sense of the light. And then it came to him. He was aboard a yacht, and the light was reflected off the water. He sat up and rubbed his eyes. The night before had been the stuff of bad dreams. He never wanted to have another like it. The nightmare had started at Kennedy Airport when his live-in girlfriend, Arrington Carter, had not shown up for the flight. She had been supposed to come directly from the magazine office where she had been meeting with an editor, but she had not arrived. Stone had found a phone and had tracked down Arrington, still at the New Yorker. "I guess you're not going to make the plane," he said. "It leaves in 20 minutes.
Stone, I'm so sorry. Everything has exploded here. I took the proposal for the profile on Vance Calder to Tina Brown, and she went for it instantly. Turns out she had tried and tried to do a piece with Vance when she was at Vanity Fair, and he would never cooperate. Vance is coming into New York tomorrow, and I've got to introduce him to Tina at lunch. There's just no getting around it."
"I see," he replied.
"Don't worry. I'm already booked on the same flight tomorrow. You go ahead to St. Mark's, take delivery of the boat, and I'll be there by midnight."
"All right," he said.
"Oh," she sighed, "I'm so relieved you're not angry. I know you can see what a break this is for me."
Stone hung up the phone and ran for his plane. Moments later, he had settled into a comfortable leather seat and had in his hand a rum and tonic in honor of his long-anticipated winter holiday. Vance Calder was, arguably, Hollywood's premier male star, and he had played an important part in Stone's and Arrington's lives already. She had been in Calder's company when they had met at a dinner party at the home of a gossip columnist nearly a year before. He hadn't believed for a moment that he could take a girl away from Vance Calder. Instead, Arrington had called him. Vance, she had explained, was no more than an acquaintance. Inside a few weeks, they were living together, and Stone had never been happier. At 42, he was still a bachelor, and he liked it that way. Living with Arrington, though, had made a lack of freedom seem very attractive, and he was determined to hang on to her. He reached St. Mark's sometime after 3 a.m. Nevertheless, he was met by the charter agent and taken to the boat, a Beneteau 36, a roomy French design, and, without unpacking, fell into the double berth in the little owner's cabin. The next morning he got out of bed and, naked, stumbled into the little galley and found half a jar of instant coffee in a cupboard. Shortly he had found the gas tap in the cockpit, boiled a kettle, and made himself a really terrible cup of coffee. There was a very nice dining table, some books, and a small television set. He turned it on and found himself looking at CNN. The marina must have a satellite dish, he thought. A major snowstorm would reach the New York City area by evening, and travel was expected to be disrupted. Thank God Arrington is getting out this afternoon, he thought. A swim might be nice, he thought, and got into some trunks and climbed into the cockpit. As he did, a yacht of about 45 feet hove into view under engine. It had a dark blue hull and teak decks, and her name, Expansive, was lettered on her bows in gilt. Two other things about the yacht caught his eye. The mainsail was still up and in tatters, and it was being steered by a quite beautiful young woman. She was small and blonde, wearing a bikini bottom and a chambray shirt knotted under her breasts. He saw a uniformed customs officer waiting to take her lines. He made himself another cup of the awful coffee and settled into the cockpit to get some sun on his all-too-white body. As he did, he saw the customs officer leave the new yacht and, at a dead run, head for the little police shack 50 yards away. Odd. A moment later, the customs officer emerged from the shack in the company of two police officers, one of them of rank, judging from his uniform. The three men marched rapidly back toward the blue yacht and went aboard, disappearing below. The young woman's skipper appeared on deck wearing a cotton dress. Accompanied by the three uniformed officers, she walked toward the police shack and disappeared inside. Stone didn't know what sort of trouble she was in, but he felt for her, alone in a foreign place, at the mercy of the police? As the sun set, he wandered across a wide green lawn toward a wide thatched roof covering a bar and restaurant open to the breezes. A black bartender stood behind an expanse of varnished mahogany, idly polishing a glass. A television set over the bar was tuned to CNN, the sound muted. "Evening to you, boss," he said amiably, with what sounded to Stone like a Bahamian accent. "Evening." He looked up at the television and saw a woman in a heavy coat standing on what looked like a New York City street corner. A blizzard was raging about her. "Shit," Stone said aloud.
"What you care, boss?" the bartender asked. "You already here."
"Yeah, but my girl isn't. She was due to leave at 4 this afternoon."
"Bad luck, boss," the man said.
"Where are you from?" Stone asked.
"Born right here on St. Mark's, boss."
"Funny. You sound Bahamian. You shining me on with that accent?" The man grinned.
"You're too good for me, pal." He stuck out his hand. "I'm Thomas Hardy, like the writer."
Stone shook his hand. "Do I hear a little New York in there somewhere?"
"Lived in Brooklyn a long time. Worked all over the city."
"I'm Stone Barrington. I'm on a charter yacht over at the marina."
"Were you ever a cop?"
Stone blinked in surprise.
"I was. Mostly in the 19th precinct."
"Have we ever met?" Thomas shook his head.
"No, but I heard about you. I was walking a beat in the village when you left the force. Everybody was talking about you. Said you got a bad deal."
"I can't complain," Stone said. "I left with the full pension after 14 years.
"Yeah, but you took some lead with you, huh?"
"No, they got it out."
"What are you doing in St. Mark's?"
"I was born here, like I said. My mama moved to New York when I was a kid. I joined the force, did my 20, and brought my savings and my pension down here and put it to work."
"This your place?"
"Lock, stock, and liquor license."
"And where can I make a phone call?"
Thomas reached under the bar, pulled out a phone, and set it on the bar.
"Got a fax machine, too, if you should need one."
"Thanks." Stone called his home number.
"Hello? I guess you're not gonna make it tonight, huh?"
"I'm sorry, baby. It started to come down around midday, and let me tell you, it's really something. But I'm already rebooked on tomorrow's flight."
"Good. What are you up to now?"
"I'm having dinner with Vance and some friends of his."
"I miss you, baby. Let me give you this number."
Stone read off both the phone and fax numbers.
"Keep me posted on the flight situation, will you? The boat is moored no more than 100 yards from this phone."
"I will, baby."
Stone said goodbye and hung up.
"Well, Thomas, it looks like you and me."
Stone watched as a large black man, dressed in a white linen suit, and in the company of a beautiful café au lait woman, entered and was shown to a prime table.
"Impressive-looking fellow," he said.
"That's Sir Winston Sutherland, the Minister of Justice," Thomas said.
"A mover and shaker?"
"He both moves and shakes. And if his own opinion holds, he just might be the next Prime Minister."
Stone heard a car door slam and turned to look. The blonde woman from the blue yacht, Expansive, had left a police car and, alone, was making her way across the lawn toward the marina.
"Very nice, huh?"
Thomas said.
"Very nice indeed. She spent the afternoon with the local cops, though. I wonder why."
"Word is, the lady left Europe with a husband, but arrived in St. Mark's without him."
"You mean she sailed it all the way across the Atlantic?"
"Well, not all the way," Thomas said. "Her husband was along for part of the time."
"With foul play suspected?" "On this island, foul play is always suspected."
"There's going to be a coroner's jury over at the town meeting house tomorrow morning. Word is, Sir Winston is asking the questions."
Stone entered the Markstown meeting hall at 10 o'clock the following morning, just as the coroner was about to call the proceedings to order. A jury of 5 black men and 1 white sat on folding chairs along one side of the hall. The coroner sat on a folding chair at a card table at the front of the room, and the woman from the blue yacht sat in the front row of chairs. Stone took a seat in the front row just as Sir Winston Sutherland made his entrance.
"These proceedings will come to order," said the coroner. "We meet to hear testimony on the death of Paul Phillips Manning. We are pleased to have Sir Winston with us to conduct questioning. Call Mrs. Allison Manning."
The woman rose and walked toward a folding chair set next to the coroner's card table.
"Do you swear by Almighty God that the evidence you are about to give will be the truth?"
the coroner asked her. "I do," Allison Manning replied.
"State your full name and age for the record."
"Allison Ames Manning. I'm 29 years old."
Mrs. Manning," Sir Winston said gently, "may I begin by expressing my condolences on the loss of your husband?"
"Thank you," she replied.
"Mrs. Manning, how long were you married to Paul Phillips Manning?"
"It would have been 4 years next month."
"And how old was your husband at his death?"
42.
"And where did the two of you reside?"
"In Greenwich, Connecticut."
"Would you be kind enough to tell us of your last months with your husband?"
Allison Manning took a deep breath and spoke in a clear, well-modulated voice. "My husband and I left Newport, Rhode Island last May and crossed the Atlantic to Plymouth in England, just the two of us. From Plymouth, we crossed the Channel and cruised the coast of Brittany. We made a long passage to Balboa in northern Spain, then went on to Lisbon and Gibraltar. In the Mediterranean, we cruised the Greek islands and then sailed out to the Canary Islands. We called at Las Palmas and did some refitting there, then at Puerto Rico, in the Canaries, which was our last port of call before starting across the Atlantic, bound for Antigua." She took a sip of water from a glass poured by the coroner. "We were 10 days out of Puerto Rico, over halfway to Antigua, when the incident occurred."
"Tell us about the incident with as much detail as you can recall."
"It was in the early afternoon of the 10th day," she said. "We had been in and out of squalls, then the wind dropped. When Paul began to unroll the sail in the light winds, the top swivel of the roller reefing gear separated into two parts. The sail fell down with the bottom part, and the top part of the gear remained at the top of the mast, attached to the halyard. I hope I'm making this clear."
"Please go on, Mrs. Manning," Sir Winston said.
"It meant that someone had to go up the mast and pull the top part of the swivel down to deck level."
"And who went up the mast?"
I did. I had done that a couple of times before, but when we were tied up alongside in port. It was easier for Paul to hoist me up the mast with a winch than for me to hoist him. He was a large man. There wasn't much wind, but there was a sea running from the last squall, and it was pretty uncomfortable at the top of the mast. I called to Paul to lower me to the deck, and that was when I saw him, sitting on a cockpit seat, holding his arm near the shoulder. For the first time, her voice quavered. His left arm. She seemed to struggle to keep control of herself. I called to him again, and he looked up at me. Then he seemed to be in terrible pain, and he sort of just lay down on his side on the cockpit seat. Tears appeared on her cheeks now. I was very frightened. I continued to call out to him in panic. A few minutes passed, I don't know how long, and then Paul slid off the seat into the cockpit sole. He just lay there face down. It was obvious that he was unconscious. He just sort of flopped about when the boat rolled.
And then what did you do?
I just clung to the mast and cried.
For how long?
A long time. 2 hours, maybe 3. I hugged the mast as tightly as I could, and then I slipped out of the bosun's chair and began sliding down the mast. I went down very quickly until I came to rest. When I could get up again, I made my way back to the cockpit. Paul was dead.
Please go on, Sir Winston said.
I couldn't get a pulse at all, and I couldn't get him to breathe, and his body was growing quite cold by this time.
Did you move the body at all?
Not at first. Paul is,
was a big man, and I'm quite small, so I left him in the cockpit that night. I was exhausted, so I got some sleep. When I woke up, it was still dark, but there was about 3/4 of a moon, so the night was bright. It was clear to me that in that climate, I was going to have to bury Paul at sea. I went up into the cockpit and tried lifting the body, but I couldn't budge it. Finally, I got the main halyard around him and winched him into...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.